We begin with terrifying developments in the Middle East that could change the region forever. Israel has made clear its mission now is to strangle the life out of Gaza, cutting off all food, water and electricity to its 2 million citizens. While Hamas is promising to execute Jewish hostages, including women and children, live on the internet. Our Europe Bureau Chief Hugh Whitfeld is in Tel Aviv tonight and Ashley Mullaney is in Jerusalem. Hugh begins our coverage.
Fire and fury. The sights and sounds of revenge. Israel's strike back is just getting started. The innocent people of Gaza now paying a terrible price. Around 700 killed so far, including at least 140 children. Thousands of people in desperate need of medical help. And for the 130 Israeli hostages being held in Gaza, a new and terrifying threat. Hamas warning it will kill one and broadcast the murder for every Israeli strike without warning on civilian homes. Men, women and children captured by Hamas being used as human shields. Among them, Romy Gonan, a 23-year-old waitress, taken at a music festival. She called her mother when the rocket started falling.
She was terrified. She was saying, "Mommy, we are trying to get out of here, but I'm bleeding."
Then she heard other voices.
Then I heard shooting all around, very close to the car, and started hearing voices in Arabic talking to each other, shouting at each other, and I was so afraid.
The Gaza Strip is now completely cut off. No food, no water, no electricity, no fuel, nowhere to run. More than 2 million Palestinians caught in the crossfire. They know much worse is to come. Israel's Defence Force hitting more than 2,000 targets with troops massing at the border, preparing for a ground invasion. A late-night meeting of Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu's war cabinet calling for the world to unite against a new terrorist threat.
Hamas terrorists bound, burned and executed children. They are savages. Hamas is ISIS.
Less than 20 kilometres from the border fence in Ashkelon, the aftermath of another indiscriminate Hamas rocket. The Israeli bomb squad inspects the impact site, the wreckage of Ayel Blechner's car nearby. He'd just pulled up and stepped into his house.
You're used to this. You live so close to Gaza.
But every time it's very scary.
The people who live in this neighbourhood do so knowing they are essentially always on the front line. And it is a life of lucky escapes. If this rocket had landed just a few metres away, it would have hit a home. And the outcome would have been very different. US warships are heading to the eastern Mediterranean, as well as planes loaded with ammunition for Israel. A joint statement from the leaders of Britain, America, France, Italy and Germany united in support of Israel, which has called up 300,000 reservists to join the fight. That's more than three times the size of Australia's entire defence force. For Sarah Vanunu, it feels like a long way from her childhood on Sydney's beaches.
We're dealing with savage, brutal people. These are terrorists. Hamas is a terrorist organisation.
Her 14-year-old Australian-born son takes us through what happens when they hear the sirens. His bedroom is the family's safe room.
Always try to keep everyone out right now because I want to feel like it's my room again and to like forget about the war.
Until the siren goes off and then it's not your room, it's everyone's room, right?
Yeah.
Every new apartment here has a room like this.
When there are missiles, you use this. Slides pretty easily and blows the glass.
One of Solly's classmates is missing. Another is dead. This teenager knows one day he will be called up for military service here.
I'm not scared. I'm not scared because it's for our country, it's for the people. And it's just, I think it's the way teachers and people grow up here. they teach us not to be afraid.
Alongside the near constant threat of rocket attacks, there is an unnerving eeriness across large parts of this country right now. Normally, these local shops would be buzzing at this time of day, but people have told me it's kind of like the COVID lockdown here right now. People are simply too scared to leave their homes. Near the site of the music festival attack where 260 people died, the rockets from Gaza keep coming.
Get in. That's it. Everybody in?
This is like a shooter situation in the US. Imagine 1,000 shooter situations happening constantly.
In Israel and the Palestinian territories, funerals are taking place for the 1,600 victims so far. Both sides know there will be many, many more.
And let's go to Hugh Whitfield, who's in Ashkelon in Israel near the border with Gaza. Hugh, troops are gathering. When is that ground invasion likely?
100,000 troops have been mobilised, Mark. That's in addition to the reservists I've just mentioned. An invasion is what military analysts would consider to be the worst-case scenario inside the Gaza Strip. Israel's army is modern, it is well-structured, sophisticated. Hamas is well-armed, but it essentially operates like a guerrilla organisation, and of course it does not have an air force. The border fence between Israel and Gaza has now been resealed. We're told that no further Hamas incursions have occurred today. What does that mean for the Israeli hostages inside? They are essentially sealed in, it seems. This whole nation holding grave fears for their safety, Mark.
Hugh Whitfield, thank you. Now to Ashley Mullaney in Jerusalem. Ashley, that shocking threat from Hamas to execute hostages for every Israeli bombing, are they now going that far?
Well, Mark, we don't yet know the fate of these hostages in Gaza, but we do know many were killed soon after capture. This is a grave situation. Women, children, grandmothers taken from their homes. These hostages, many of them Israeli soldiers too, they are being held in Gaza. It is such a small area, so closely watched, but it will be extremely difficult to get them out. It is likely they will become bargaining chips for a prisoner swap, at worst, human shields in this bloody conflict.
We're here, she says, under the bush, hiding from terrorists. At the Supernova Music Festival, a walk through the campground became Run For Your Life.
And we're getting into the first bush we saw. We've been in this bush for 8 hours. I still don't know how many friends have I lost. I know that people that were left behind in the party were murdered on the spot.
It started like this and ended with this. An unwitting face of the festival horror now has a name. This is 25-year-old Noah Agamani. Like the rest of the world, her father Yaakov has watched this clip on a loop. You don't want to believe it, he says, even though you can clearly see it's your daughter. One by one, they were marched through the dirt and taken away. Dozens of them likely held here in tunnels below Gaza.
We don't have any proof of their state. If my cousin and her husband are alive.
Yifat Zalia is missing a cousin. She's seen here holding two baby boys. Yoni Asher is missing an entire young family. Here they are in the back of a truck.
These are babies. Babies. Women, families. You can't do this kind of things.
And after the killings and captures, anything left was trashed and burnt. When police arrived, it was all too late.
This is my mum's car now, gone on fire.
Elsewhere on the border, Noam Agi is missing his mum.
She said, I hear them outside.
He watched live as Palestinian TV broadcast a raid on her home.
When the army came for her house at around 4 p.m., they only found bloodstains. Her phone is not there, and she is not there.
In Jerusalem, Ashley Mullaney, 7 News.
And political editor Mark Riley joins me now from Canberra. Mark, is there an update on any Australians who may have been taken hostage?
Good evening, Mark. Yes, senior officials remain deeply concerned tonight about that Australian woman who we revealed last night may have been taken hostage by Hamas terrorists. Now, no minister is talking publicly about her case yet, but I've confirmed that our embassy officials hold grave concerns for her tonight and are providing consular assistance to her family at a terrible time. Officials haven't been able to provide any concrete information about her whereabouts for the second consecutive day, and that has the government fearing the worst. At the same time, concerns are growing within government that the public protests we're seeing on the streets here could ignite violent confrontations and divisions. The government now calling for calm.
I'm concerned about the rise of anti-Semitism. I'm concerned as well about Islamophobia.
We respect each other, we deal with each other respectfully, and we don't engage in hate speech.
Anthony Albanese described those scenes in Sydney last night with Palestinian protesters chanting obscenities about the Jewish people as horrific. Mark.
Mark Rowley in Canberra, thank you. Flares were thrown, anti-Semitic slurs chanted, and an Israeli flag set on fire during that illegal pro-Palestinian rally last night at the Opera House. Anger is growing about why police allowed the demonstration while warning Sydney's Jewish community to stay home.
They were fired up. Frenzied. What was meant to be a peaceful pro-Palestine demonstration, anything but. As an Israeli flag was set alight, flares thrown, and anti-Semitic slurs chanted. In front of one of Sydney's most famous landmarks, the Opera House was last night lit up blue and white in solidarity with Israel, that public support angering these protesters. The rally started at Town Hall. The crowd quickly swelling to 1,500. Also there, Jewish man Mark Spiro carrying an Israeli flag. He was the only person arrested.
You've been arrested in relation to the
arrested?
For doing what?
For what?
Having a flag.
Breaching the peace.
Multiple police had me in my arms locked and trying to wrestle my flag away.
Members of the Jewish community had been warned not to attend. Mark Spiro says it was his right.
In the year 2023, Jews living in Sydney no longer feel safe.
He was removed for his safety.
Mark Leash, the son of a Holocaust survivor, also attended with his daughter, chased away after pulling out his Israeli flag.
You're just not safe, even in Australia, purely because you're Jewish.
For Jews to be told you should stay home because we can't guarantee your safety in Sydney is... it's abhorrent.
The police admitted they told Jewish people to stay away.
Indicated to them that people attending these positions can put themselves at significant risk.
But the Premier today said the unauthorised rally shouldn't have been allowed.
I don't think that protest should have gone ahead.
The police are not here to make political judgment calls about who should have the right to protest.
The Premier dodging demands for an apology for lighting up the Opera House.
It was my decision. I believe it was the right decision.
New South Wales police have now launched a dedicated task force which will be reviewing social media video of the demonstration last night. They say anyone caught taking part in racial vilification or incitement of hatred or violence will be charged.
I would call on the police and the Attorney General to prosecute to the full extent of the law.
Annie Puller, 7 News.
The horror of what happened in Israel has touched one Sydney family more than most. They were talking to friends, a couple and their 3 young children near Gaza, right up until they were murdered by Hamas militants.
Coming to terms with unimaginable grief.
We just can't understand what happened, and we can't digest it in any way.
A loss that is unbearable for Moore and Yishai Lakob. On Saturday morning, Tamar, her husband Johnny and their 3 children ran for shelter as rockets launched in the Nir Uz kibbutz in southern Israel.
She texted in the WhatsApp group, "Hi guys, just wanted to let you all know I'm safe with my family."
Hours later, nothing.
We saw videos of people getting kidnapped. We wanted to know what's going on, but we couldn't find her.
Hamas militants broke into their shelter murdering all five of them.
No one could ever believe that such a thing can happen, and to be inside your house and to get killed in your house, surrounded by your kids, it's horrible.
Their kids were close friends.
The kids were always happy, always jumping, always laughing. It's like something like a crazy happiness.
Yishai was mentored by Tamar at university.
She was always so nice, always so supportive. And also the time we need Tamar and she's gone.
A grief being felt by so many Jewish families right now. Angelique Opie, 7 News.